Welcome back to another episode of the CSK8 podcast. My name is Jared O'Leary. Each episode of this podcast is either a solo episode where I unpack some scholarship in relation to computer science education, or an episode with a guest or multiple guests. In this week's episode, I'm chatting with Mitch Resnick, who might be most well known for being a professor at MIT in the Lifelong Kindergarten Group, which might be best known for working on Scratch, but they also do a lot of other really cool projects. In our discussion, we chat about the misconceptions people have around the four P's of projects, passion, peers, and play in Mitch's book, Lifelong Kindergarten, as well as how to encourage depth of understanding while playing, what has surprised Mitch during his career, how to encourage online communication and collaboration without creating artificial engagement, what Mitch wishes we'd see more of and discuss more of in CS education, our pet peeves with unplugged activities and computational thinking, accounting for survivorship bias with Scratch, expanding our focus on equity and inclusion to include both the who and the how, the importance of experimenting and learning through play, and so much more. As with each one of the episodes, the show notes includes links to relevant resources that we mention in this particular podcast, so make sure you click the link in the app that you're listening to this on, or visit jaredoleary.com and click on the podcast tab. By the way, if you're interested in getting started with Scratch or are already using it, I highly recommend checking out the resources that I have created and shared on my website and through bootuppd.org, which is the nonprofit that I work for. All the resources are 100% free, so not selling anything. Anyways, we will now begin with an introduction by Mitch.
Hi, I'm Mitch Resnick. I'm a professor at the MIT Media Lab, where I lead a group called the Lifelong Kindergarten Group. And we call it Lifelong Kindergarten because I've always been inspired by the way children learn in kindergarten, where they're playfully creating things in collaboration with one another. And in our group, we try to take that type of learning and spread it to learners of all ages. We think it shouldn't just be for five-year-olds, but we think, especially to thrive in today's fast-changing world, everyone needs to have a more of a kindergarten approach to learning.
Can you tell me the story of how you got into computer science education?
I got started when I first met someone who became my influential mentor, Seymour Papert. And Seymour was one of the great pioneers of technology and education. I met him in the early 1980s. At the time, I'd been working as a science journalist, and I was writing about different technologies and sciences. So I think I was always interested in communicating ideas, and I was doing that as a journalist. And then I went to an event. It was called the West Coast Computer Fair. It was a little bit like an early version of a maker fair before there were maker fairs. And it was many of the early computer hobbyists. It was right after personal computers had first come out. And Seymour was giving a keynote talk at the West Coast Computer Fair. And I was just really inspired by what he had talked about. Because I think I had seen computers. I knew I'd enjoyed programming computers, and I knew the productive ways they could be used in society. But Seymour gave a different vision of computers. It wasn't just about getting a task done, but enabling us to express ourselves in new ways and see the world in new ways. So it opened my mind to thinking about computers in a whole new way. I'd always enjoyed working with kids. I'd been a camp counselor. So a lot of things came together. I had this sort of, this more inspirational, vision from what Seymour was doing. It connected with a lot of my interests of enjoying working with kids, enjoying communicating, helping people learn things. Journalism was one way of helping people learn things, but doing things in education was a way that really resonated with me. So based on that, I ended up coming to MIT, where Seymour was a professor, and I ended up becoming a graduate student, working with Seymour and others. And from there, that was like in the mid-1980s, and I've been working on the similar types of things ever since. Of course, there's always new projects and new technologies, but I think that core idea was one that I became fascinated with then, and I feel really fortunate. It's been like a guiding set of values ever since then.
So one of the things that I'm really interested in is like how people's philosophies of education have kind of changed over time. I'm curious if you can think back, like before you met Seymour, like what was your philosophy of education and how did that change after the fact?
I don't think I'd explicitly thought about a philosophy of education because I wasn't in the world of education before that. Mm-hmm. I think there's some clues just to the way the things I've been engaged with. Like when I was growing up, I did enjoy creating and making things. I sometimes tell the story about, digging up my backyard and making my own mini golf course. So I wasn't just interested in playing sports, but creating my own little golf course. In middle school, when we had to do a science fair project, rather than doing some type of hypothesis and test on the hypothesis, I made a type of museum exhibit. I think I'd always enjoyed going to a science museum. So I enjoyed like making these exhibits to help people understand things. But by making it, I was also understanding things better. So I think that approach of museums and doing things based on your interests and creating things were always part of the way I learned things. But I hadn't really thought about it as a philosophy of education. But when I heard Seymour talk about it, it sort of resonated. It sort of felt right to me, and it aligned with some of the ways I'd been learning. It also, it felt like a humane approach to education. It represented the type of world that I would like to live in. So I hadn't really thought about it beforehand, but it really represented not just computer science education, but more an approach to learning that was really valuing and respecting children. And I think I grew up in a family that valued education and valued, you know, supporting children and their learning activities. So it was really respectful and valuing of children and their own explorations and ideas in a way that really resonated with me.
Yeah, being totally on board with what you're saying, I often see that the discourse around education is almost the opposite of that. It's not valuing what somebody knows, especially kids, and it's saying, oh, well, I, as the educator or standards developer or curriculum developer, I'm the one who's going to set the direction and you need to learn this. And if you don't want to learn it, well, then you'll just fail the class or need to retake a class, etc. So it's like almost like it's flipped. And I wish that that would change in the modern discourse around education.
Yeah, I totally agree. And I do think at least a central thing that I learned from Seymour and then have been supporting over the last 30 or 40 years is that too much of education is based on a model that might be called a transmission model or a delivery model, where you're delivering instruction or delivering information. And as you said, trying to flip that, so it's less about delivering instruction, but more creating an environment where people can investigate, explore, experiment, and learn through those investigations and experiments and design experiences. So it's really supporting the learner in their, you know, creative explorations as opposed to delivering instruction and information. But you're right that it goes against, I think, that other is a dominant paradigm. And it can be seen as something that's very efficient and something that is easier to put together. And to be honest, with every new generation of technology, it feels that we fight the same battle. With every new technology, it first gets used as a way to deliver information, deliver instruction.
Yep.
And we always have to sort of push to get people to think about it otherwise, of just creating environments that can support people in their exploring, experimenting, and learning.
Yeah, I just had flashbacks when like one-to-one devices, like when iPads were being implemented in schools. It's just basically a digital whiteboard and whatnot. So that definitely resonates. I was fortunate that I had some administrators in the last school that I was in who were very supportive of the classes that I was doing. They would frequently walk into the room and be like, how did you get those kids engaged? And I was like, well, I'm not forcing them to do something they don't want to do. I'm asking, what are you interested in? How can you explore that through code? I have seen pushback from other like colleagues or administrators in other schools and other contexts and whatnot. And so in a previous podcast that I did, it was talking about the four P's, like the projects, peers, passion, and play. I posed a question at the end and was like, what principles are missing from the four P's of creative learning? So I'm curious, like when you've heard criticism or skepticism, when you discuss the four P's, what do they feel is missing, or why do they think that that would not apply in their particular context?
I think sometimes the pushback comes from a misinterpretation. Sometimes people hear about the type of approaches that Seymour Papert talked about and that I have been trying to support, and they sometimes will call it an unstructured approach to education. Mm. As if there's, and they make it into this dichotomy. Either we're providing some structure about what children should learn, or when they say unstructured, they mean let them do anything.
Right.
And I think our approach should not be seen as let them do anything. And when you use words like play, as we do in one of the four P's, sometimes people interpret that way, let them do whatever. And that's really not what I'm encouraging. I do want to provide a lot of agency for the learner and allow them opportunities to follow their interests. But there's a lot of structure and support to enable them to succeed. So we want to allow people to follow their interests, but then we need to provide them support. So I sometimes say that we want to provide enough freedom for them to follow their fantasies, but enough structure and support so they can turn their fantasies into realities. Because without that structure and support, you know, they could just go off in all different ways and they won't necessarily be able to succeed at following their fantasies. But I do think it's so important to allow people to work on things that are meaningful to them. And one reason maybe it hasn't become more widespread is that it's not always easy to support that. Because if you have a classroom of 30 kids and they're following their own interests, there's some challenges in supporting that. Whereas if you have everybody doing the exact same exercise, following the same step-by-step instructions, it's then easier to evaluate how well are they making progress towards the same goal that they're all aiming for, the exact same goal. It's easier to evaluate and measure their progress. But it's also kids end up not being engaged and they don't get as much from it. I think one thing we've seen over and over is that when young people are working on things that they really care about, not only will they work longer and harder, but they'll make deeper connections to the ideas that are part of the activity. But it does require a different approach on the role of the teacher or the mentor or the facilitator in order to support young people as they're doing it. I sometimes quote a line from John Dewey, the great educator and philosopher, like probably 100 years ago. Dewey was talking about some of these same things. These are not all new ideas. And when Dewey described his approach to education, at one point he wrote, he said, it's simple, but not easy. And what I think he meant by that is you can describe it simply. I describe it in 4 P's. He described it other ways. So you can describe it simply, but it's not easy to put it into practice. To know how to support it requires a different approach to teaching and facilitating.
Yeah, that really resonates. I'll include some links in the show notes to some of the presentations I've done and even prior podcasts that talks about like rhizomatic learning and how you can have it if there's 30 kids in the class going through 30 different projects at the same time. And then like Affinity Spaces by James Paul G. I did an episode that talked about that. So like there's a lot of things that you can put into support, and it, like what Mitch was just saying, it sounds really easy. Like, oh, all you're doing is facilitating, working with kids one-on-one. But there's so many resources and like things community-wise, culturally, that you have to set up in advance and on the fly to really support this. But I want to highlight one of the things that you mentioned. So like a lot of people, when they maybe think of kindergarten, they think of playful and fun and whatnot. So if we have a lifelong kindergarten group, awesome. It's playful, it's fun. But how do you get that depth? And so having a background in music education and like skill development related to learning how to play an instrument, and having done this, I know that like the same things that you can do in a very structured sequential learning environment can be done through play, learning a skill and whatnot. But I'm curious, how do you respond to people who are like, okay, but how do you encourage them to not just skim on the surface of CS or coding?
Well, I do think by having them have a meaningful experience, when people are working on something they care about, they're going to dive into it and go deeply with it. They don't want to skim the surface because they care about it. Mm-hmm. You know, and as part of that diving into it, they might need to do some things that are very structured and even sort of repetitive in ways that might not seem part of a playful process, but they're willing to do it because they care about it. You know, now this research about in order to become, to get expertise, you have to do things in a repetitive way over a long period of time. My first reaction was, well, that feels that it's going in a different direction than what I believe. But then I realized that sometimes it's important to be able to sort of repetitively practice something, and practice can be very important. But if someone really wants to get expertise, they're only going to be motivated for that practice if they really care about what they're doing. So this idea of doing things you care about is not at odds with practice, it's aligned with practice. Once you really care about something, you're willing to put in the hard work. Maybe that gets to another, you know, a lot of times a misinterpretation. People think if you talk about play that we want to make things easy, and we're not looking to make things easy. And I don't think kids want things to be easy. They want things to be meaningful, and they're willing to work hard if they're doing something that's meaningful, connected to their interests. So the goal should not be to make things easy. Now, of course, we don't want things difficult for reasons that don't matter. You should try to, you know, make things easy to use. But it's not that you want to make things easy for kids. It's to make progress on something, you do have to work hard. But people are willing to work hard if you know, they really care about it.
Yeah, at least in the like competitive performance world for music education, they would often have rating systems where it's like, this is a level one piece, this is a level five piece. Level five is very advanced, difficult. Level one is more like, this is your first year playing through that instrument. I would frequently have kids that I would work with, and even with myself, where their average performance level might be at like a two, but they really want to learn this piece that's a level four. And they're so committed to it. Like, yes, it's way above like their current ability level, but because they're so interested in it, they're willing to put in that grind and really sit there and work through it that they might not be if they were handed a level two piece.
Yeah. And even like when before I was saying that generally we try to avoid the delivery model of delivering instruction.
Yeah.
On the other hand, when kids are ready to learn something and they seek out delivery of instruction, it can be very, you know, useful.
Right.
I thought about that in connection with, you know, sites like Khan Academy. You know, I would not think it's a good idea just to turn over the whole third grade curriculum to just kids sitting in front of one video after another of, you know, getting instruction from a Khan Academy video. On the other hand, we've had some kids who are learning to program it in our Scratch programming language, and they're working on a game and they want to learn something and they get stuck. And then they'll look at Khan Academy and find a video that teaches them how to do the things that were keeping them stuck. And that's really useful where they can turn and get that instruction when they need it. It's a wonderful thing.
Yeah, that just-in-time learning is key. Some of our most popular videos on BootUp's YouTube channel are those like Scratch tips that we do where it's like, here's how to use variables to keep a timer or to keep score, or here's one way that you can use your backpack to make your life easier when working in Scratch, et cetera. And like, those are very popular. And the most comments that we get are usually like, you just saved me. Now I know how to create a start button for my game, or like things like that. And so having that just in time, like, oh, I have this question, let me find an answer to that. It works great. That's how I tried to approach the classroom as well, where it was like, okay, I'm not going to come up and lecture. I'll be walking around the entire time, helping you out, encouraging peers to kind of collaborate with each other and whatnot. And it worked great. And I happen to have administrators who supported it. But like I said, not everybody has that. You've already mentioned some misconceptions about some of your work. I'm curious, are there any more that haven't been discussed? Or
the ones we talked about, I do think finding the right balance between sort of structure and freedom is the key dimension that people don't need to get a better understanding of. And it shouldn't be seen as a dichotomy, but finding the right way to have the right, you know, mix between them, to me, is the most important thing.
Yeah, having taught some undergrad and graduate courses, typically undergrads will learn about constructionism or constructivism, and they'll be like, oh, this is great. But then they'll take it to an extreme where they're like, okay, I need to avoid any form of direct instruction. And if somebody has a question, I can never answer it. I can only respond in questions, et cetera, et cetera. And it's like, no, there's moments for that.
That reminds me of a story, you know, I'd helped start this network of after-school learning centers called Computer Clubhouses. It was started by my close colleague, Natalie Rusk, and I worked with Natalie on this. And we started with one clubhouse in Boston. Now there's a whole network of 100 clubhouses around the world. And the clubhouses are based on this approach to, you know, learning, a creative approach with projects, passion, peers, and play. I remember one time visiting a clubhouse where there was a new mentor that was coming in. They rely on volunteer mentors to come in and support the young people coming into the clubhouses to work on creative projects. And the mentor came in, and I think they were suggesting something like they enjoyed making different types of animated comic books. And they said, I'd be interested in running a workshop for kids. I could come in on Tuesdays and run workshops on animated comic books. And the coordinator of the clubhouse said, no, here at the clubhouse, we don't run workshops. We let kids do things that they want to work on. I said, no, that's exactly the wrong thing. Because I think it would be a problem if you said, everyone at the clubhouse must make an animated comic book, would not be good. But if this mentor wants to come in and do a workshop about animated comic books for kids who are interested in learning it, that's great. So just as you said, it's not a matter of just standing back and let the young people do whatever they want or only coming in when they have a question for you. It's fine to, you know, interject things. The point is, it should be up to the young people to decide whether they're interested in doing that or not.
Yeah. I'm curious, what is something that has surprised you over the course of your career?
I think the place where I've sort of learned the most and been the most surprised is on the social side of learning. I got started by focusing a lot on developing tools to let kids express themselves creatively. Again, as I mentioned, I was inspired not just by the ideas of Seymour Papert, but his Logo programming language. there was a programming language for kids that, you know, came out with the early personal computers. And it was a way for kids to be able to create things on the computers. And I started working on projects that gave kids new abilities to design and create and experiment and explore. And although I understood the importance of learning with and from others, I hadn't focused on it as much. As we started working on our Scratch software, which was very much inspired by Logo, with Scratch, we made a graphical programming language, which made it, you know, removed a lot of the syntax challenges, and you didn't have to learn the complex punctuation and grammar that you did with a text-based language. We also added control over media so kids could more easily do things with animations and sound and music. But another element we added was a social dimension. So I sort of knew that it was important to add a social dimension. And we started working on Scratch in the early 2000s, right as the internet was becoming more popular. But I must admit, I didn't recognize how profound a difference the internet was going to make in the learning opportunities and the way that we would develop Scratch. We had the idea that we would want kids to be able to share their projects, but we didn't quite know what that meant. I was very fortunate being at a university. We had graduate students who had grown up on the internet. It was a generation younger than I was. And they had so much better intuitions about the way that this could be used to support collaboration and sharing. And then once we launched Scratch in 2007, the thing that surprised me the most were all the creative ways that young people used the community and the collaboration possibilities. Of course, they're also doing just great, you know, stories and games and animations with Scratch, but the way they interact with each other is what really surprised me and blew me away. Everything from, you know, kids would start work on a project, and then if they, you know, would put out a call for help and say, here's my project. I want to add another character. I'm not quite sure about it. You know, if you create a character, I'll add it to my project. So people were, you know, calling out for other people. They were crowdsourcing for their project. Other people would offer their consulting services. They would say, I really enjoy making background music for projects. If you need background music, I'll add it to your project. And then, of course, we made Scratch so you could easily remix each other's projects. We were amazed that about a third of the projects that came on Scratch were remixes. People saw other projects, made changes to other people's projects, and then added it to the community. I never expected. Again, I think my next generation graduate students did expect this, but I was really surprised at the wide range of ways that kids were collaborating and how the creativity and collaboration were so linked together that because of the collaboration, they were able to do more creative things. And because of their creativity, they were more interested in collaborating.
Yeah, so people like James Paul G have talked about how you can't really force that kind of collaboration on these kind of informal spaces and whatnot. I've seen a lot of teachers in particular over this last year and a half, because of COVID and remote learning, they have tried to create like post one discussion board question and respond to other people's questions. Like they've tried to force this kind of community engagement to try and simulate conversations and whatnot. I'm curious, from what you've learned, how do you encourage that kind of engagement without forcing it or making it artificial?
It's always trying to keep things authentic. So when kids are working on things that they really care about, then it comes more naturally. First of all, they'll be more responsive to suggestions. If they're working on a project that they really care about, they're making a game that they want other people to use, when they get suggestions, they'll be responsive to those suggestions because it's not just to complete an assignment. If you're completing an assignment for school, you want to be finished with it and someone gives you a suggestion, you didn't want to hear it. You already finished the assignment. But if you're creating something that you want others to use, you want to have the suggestion because it's going to make something that's more appealing to others. And also, once you feel that you're a member of the community, you feel invested in helping out others. That's one of the things that I think has been one of the greatest satisfactions with Scratch, is the degree to which young people have cared about helping one another and sort of the type of kindness they have in supporting one another. And I do think it's because they feel that they're part of a shared community, but it has to have an authentic feel. It's an authentic community. They weren't just thrown together. They chose to be there. They want other people to be, you know, looking at their projects, using their projects, giving feedback and suggestions. So they're more willing to do the same for others. And we did see a lot of this during the pandemic. So as you mentioned, there's a lot more focus on online learning during the pandemic and some pushing towards collaboration, but sometimes pushing rather than just opening up the possibilities. And we did see that also. It really was satisfying to us to see the growth of the types of collaboration in the Scratch community. Like one thing we saw in the last year, the number of projects shared in the Scratch community roughly doubled over the year before. There was a lot more activity, partly because kids at home, secluded, isolated during the pandemic, wanted a place to come to share ideas, to do creative work. But interestingly, the number of projects doubled. The number of comments went up fivefold.
Huh.
It wasn't just that kids were being participating more and making more projects. They were engaging more with one another. So I see that, and it feels to me, you can feel this yearning for connection. And for me, that's one of the lessons of the pandemic. You see the importance of connection, and kids isolated in their homes were yearning for connection. So they were doing even more commenting and suggesting on other people's projects. And I hope that's a lesson that we learn as we hopefully over time move beyond that, the importance of connection and community in learning. I think the pandemic highlighted that schools that were just trying to deliver instruction oftentimes had a hard time engaging young people online, where those that paid more attention to the human needs of kids were the most successful. So I hope that we can take that as a lesson. It shouldn't be just when you're isolated at home, but at all times, we need to do a better job of supporting connection and community. And hopefully that will be an important thing that comes out of the pandemic.
Are there any differences in how teachers have been engaging in the community?
We have seen some teachers. A teacher that we interviewed in the Chicago Public Schools, a wonderful principal, who, because of the pandemic, made lots of changes in the school. So they were doing things on Scratch, but also in other ways as well. But she turned her school to be much more project-oriented, because she realized that in order to keep kids engaged and motivated, to let them follow up on their own interests, work on projects, and then they would make presentations about their projects. So the school became much more project-oriented during the pandemic. And she said that in some ways, you know, that although all the terrible, you know, tragedy from the pandemic, it was something that opened up new opportunities for trying out things. I do think she was partly freed up to try things out because there weren't as many constraints on her. There were fewer standardized end-of-the-year tests that kids had to be prepared for. So she was able to make different types of changes that opened up new learning experiences and then really enriched the learning experience.
Yeah, I'm glad they are able to frame that in a positive light. I'm wondering, what do you wish you would see more of either in Scratch or in CS education?
I do think, if I think of CS education, but also it then leaks over into Scratch, more focus on kids creating things. Now, in some ways that seems natural to me. You know, when you're coding, you can create things, but that's often not at the core of CS education. Oftentimes the real focus is on concepts, of learning particular concepts. And again, learning concepts is important, but I do think we can best learn concepts through creating things. Too often schools think you have to learn the concepts first and then you can create things. Whether this with coding or any other activity, they think learn the basics first, then you can work on projects. And I think our view is you should be able to learn the concepts through projects, not before projects. And it's why we made the whole structure of Scratch is so project-based. It's not just about learning, solving a puzzle to learn a certain concept. It's about work on a project you care about and learning the concepts through doing that. And in a lot of places, that's not what CS education is about. And unfortunately, even though we tried to design Scratch to highlight the importance of work on projects and creating things and iteratively refining your creations, it's not always used that way. So too often we do see Scratch used in a way where it's just learning the core concepts and the technical skills of coding, and it misses what we think is most important. And we've seen this at times. There's one story that sticks in my head at one of our Scratch conferences that we had with educators all coming together here at the MIT Media Lab for several days of sharing experiences and learning new ways of using Scratch in the classroom. And at a reflection session at the end of the conference, there was an educator from Hong Kong that stood up and said he was like embarrassed to admit that until now, he'd been realized that he was using Scratch, quote, the wrong way. And he said his kids had not enjoyed it and the teachers in his school had not enjoyed it because it was just being used to teach them a particular set of skills. And he now saw the opportunity of using it for kids to work on meaningful projects and learn through that. And said it just opened his mind to new ways. So of course, I was very happy that the conference had led him to understand new ways of thinking about Scratch and computer science education. But of course, I was sad that the teachers and children in his school had been using it in a different way until then. And in many other places, I'm sure a similar thing happens. So I do think we need to make that transition of not just thinking about learning concepts and technical skills, not to say those are bad things, those are good things, but need to do it in the context of creating.
Yeah, we've had some districts that we've worked with who will ask, hey, do you have like a one pager that shows like all of the standards alignments and concepts alignments, et cetera, with the curriculum that I create? I'm like, no, we don't. But what we encourage you to do is focus on just going through projects that kids are interested in. You can go in any order you want, and they'll happen to learn concepts and practices, standards along the way. And if you happen to notice some gaps later on, then cool. Here are like five projects that kind of address those. Pick one that looks interesting to you. What people don't understand is like when I created this curriculum, I didn't look at the standards. I didn't look at the concepts, the practices. I just went with what are kids interested in and how can we go through those interests in a way that's meaningful to them. And then let's find some standards that happen to align with it after the fact. But people often start with the opposite of that. So I'm wondering, what do you wish you would see less of? So if we were to flip that question from more of in CS education, what do you wish you'd see less of in Scratch or CS Ed?
Well, following up, I mean, less focus on just learning the concepts. Also, sometimes around in our research group here, we have a pet peeve around the way some people use unplugged activities. Now, it's not that there's a problem with all unplugged activities. It's great to do some physical world activities and there can be value in it. And we do some of them. But too often, unplugged activities are used in a way to focus only on the concept and not on the making of things. Now, of course, in some places, they're, you know, it's argued you don't have access to the technology. There can be good reasons for doing it. And also, there can be unplugged activities which do involve creating and making. So I can imagine some things without the technology where you're creating and making and learning some things. But I think the reason some people find it appealing because it can focus in on just learning the concepts without all that clutter of dealing with the problems of making things. But in my mind, the clutter is what's important, and that the activity of creating, reflecting on your creation, modifying your creation is where you make a deeper connection to the concepts.
Yeah, I feel the same way, honestly, about how a lot of people describe computational thinking. It's without application of that understanding. Okay, you learn decomposition, but why? Okay, you learn pattern recognition, but what are you going to use it for? How are you going to create? How are you going to model?
Yeah, and even the phrase computational thinking, again, it's hard to argue with. There's clearly important ideas, and we highlight some of those ideas of computational thinking. But the problem is, if it's focused only on the thinking part without the creating part. So we'll often focus that we're interested in computational thinking in the context of computational fluency. When we say fluency, it means being able to create things and express yourself with the technology. And when you're able to express yourself, you do learn those important computational thinking concepts and computational thinking skills, but in the context of learning to express yourself. We often make the analogy with learning to write. And we've been inspired by some of the approaches of educators who come up with ways of supporting young people learning to write by expressing themselves. And try to have an alternative to the way that in too many places, kids learn to write by focusing on spelling, punctuation, and grammar. It's not that spelling, punctuation, and grammar are bad. It's good things to learn. But if you only focus on spelling, punctuation, and grammar, you're not going to fall in love with writing.
Yep.
So we're inspired by places that have focused on learning to write by telling stories. And once you tell stories, you want to learn spelling so that people will understand your stories that you write. But the focus should be on telling the stories and learning how to share your ideas. And we think the same with coding, that sometimes a lot of approaches to coding focus too much on the grammar, punctuation, and spelling side of coding. You'll learn some things there, and you might learn some concepts there, and you might learn some of those computational thinking concepts. But for us, it's both going to be more successful and most meaningful for kids if it's done in the context of the equivalent of telling stories is creating your own, you know, interactive stories, games, animations on the computer.
Yeah, that parallel with writing definitely resonates with me. Having like all my degrees in music education, I've gone through 8 semesters of music theory classes, and it's spending 8 semesters of analyzing music and basically looking at the grammar and punctuation, but never creating your own music. And it's so decontextualized that I ended up hating it. Like, I had no joy in taking those classes. But if you were to ask me to write music on my own, yeah, I'd love to do that. I wish I had actual composition classes and whatnot. And so I'm afraid that like CT and even CS might head in that direction where it's like we're learning these concepts without applying it in some kind of creative or expressive way.
Totally agree. And it's important to emphasize to people just by focusing on the joy and the expression doesn't mean learning the technique is unimportant, because in order to really be able to express yourself, you will need to learn that technique.
Yep.
But you should do it in the context of expressing.
I'm wondering, how do you account for the survivorship bias that might happen with Scratch? So you have millions of kids who are creating these awesome projects in there, and it works really well for them. They absolutely love it. But then you have some kids who might not engage with it, and they end up leaving the platform. So how do you account for that and like learn from, oh, what is it about it, Scratch, that was not appealing to a small subset of students?
Well, it is challenging. If you only look at the projects on the online community, you will see the projects of kids who succeeded in sharing something in the online community, and you don't see what happened to the kids who lost interest before they shared. Obviously, you can learn a lot by looking at the projects in the online community, but as you said, you might miss some things. So I think it's also important continuing to work with kids in person, and you know, to see what they're doing and to see where they lose interest and where they run into challenges. So we continue to, in our research group, go out and do workshops with both young people and educators locally to introduce new features and to see, you know, how they engage with them, what they find challenging, what they find interesting or not interesting. So I think continuing to engage with people individually is really important to get a sense of what's going to be working and what's not. Working individually, but also then relying on networks of people you trust who are doing that. So we learn a lot just from what other people tell us, and you know, other educators we've worked with for years who will then talk with us about what's working, what's not working. So relying on a network of trusted colleagues who can report about what's working, what's not.
Yeah, and you're fortunate that you have such a huge reach. I mean, Scratch is used around the world, so you can get many different perspectives.
Yeah, and we always learn so much, you know, when we have like this Scratch conference. Some of it, of course, is a way for us to share our new ideas with the educators who come. But just as important, we learn so much from the educators. So the educators come, and they're often surprised because they feel that they're just an educator working in a, you know, fifth grade classroom in some small town somewhere. And what do they have to offer? But when they tell their stories, we learn so much from that. So actually at the last in-person Scratch conference, we set up a booth called Scratch Stories. And we just recorded educators telling their Scratch story about something where they were proud of that happened in their classroom or a challenge in their classroom. To just us hearing those Scratch stories is so important.
I don't think I actually saw that booth when I was there, but it was a wonderful conference. So whether it's virtual again next time or eventually in person, I highly recommend people attend it. If I were to like just give you a magic wand and you could change something about the discourse in CS education or like the purpose around CS, what would you change and why?
Well, there are probably a few things. There's both sort of the goals and the methods. Well, let me start with the methods. We've already been talking some about changing the methods. The methods shouldn't just be, you know, teaching to learn concepts or giving a prompt to learn a concept, but method should be more allowing people to express themselves and learn through the projects they create. But I think the goals also need to be rethought, that oftentimes it gets introduced purely on the grounds of trajectory towards becoming a professional programmer or computer scientist. So the job opportunities. And it's important to emphasize there are great job opportunities. So it's not that that's a false narrative. It's a true narrative. If you get engaged with this and become excited about it and invest yourself in learning more about programming and computer science, there are great job opportunities. But that should not be the only reason for doing it. The same reason you shouldn't learn to write because you want to become a journalist or a novelist. There are great opportunities as a journalist or a novelist, but there are other reasons to learn to write. So similarly with computer science, getting a job as a programmer or computer scientist might be one reason, but we shouldn't focus so much on that. And a lot of it is, if we introduce coding and computer science, you know, the right way, it will help kids learn some sort of skills that will be important to them no matter what they do. So we often say our main goal is to help young people learn to think creatively, reason systematically, and work collaboratively. And I think those are skills that will be important to everybody in tomorrow's society. In a society that continues to change very rapidly and there's a lot of unpredictability, thinking creatively is important to be able to come up with new ideas in an ever-changing world. So creative thinking is important. Systematic reasoning, which certainly comes from programming, even if you're not actually programming in the future, the type of systematic reasoning that comes from it is useful in all types of problem solving. And then working collaboratively, you know, in order to tackle the types of problems and projects that are needed in the future, you need to be able to work with other people. So I get most excited when computer science education embraces that as a goal of thinking creatively, reasoning systematically, and working collaboratively as a main goal rather than just the job opportunities from developing programming technical skills.
Yeah, one of the examples that I frequently have given, like when working with kids and whatnot, and they'd be like, well, why do I need to know this? And I was like, well, I've created some games for myself and for my friends. I proposed my wife by modding a video game. So like I changed the code in Minecraft, put our dogs in it, all sorts of fun stuff. I didn't have to learn Java. I wanted to get married. I thought it'd be a fun way to do that. So there's a lot of ways that you can express yourself, but like September, when we're recording this, is National Suicide Prevention Month. And so like it's on my mind that mental health is this thing that we need to address more and talk about more, especially in K-12 context. And like thinking of programming as and CS as a way of a creative expression and being able to like explore your own thoughts and your own interests and whatnot, like it's so beneficial from a therapeutic standpoint. My wife, by the way, is a therapist, so like we talk about it frequently. But it's one of those things where it's just like it's not discussed enough. We focus so much on the jobs, we don't talk about like all the health benefits you can get from just expressing yourself through code.
Yeah. And of course, I don't want to underplay the economic opportunities.
Right.
And not just as jobs as a programmer, but by learning these skills, it'll help you in all types of work. But we're not just focused on the workplace. If done well, it's going to be supporting you in your work life, but also in your personal life and in your community life, as you were saying. Just enable to, you know, lead a satisfying, fulfilling personal life, to be an active contributor to your local community. You know, these types of skills, it's important that we have all of those in our goals, not just your work life, which is important, but your personal life and your community life, your civic life are very, very important.
I'm wondering, like building off of that, how do you work through the pressures that can come with like working in the field of education as a scholar, working at MIT? Like you, I imagine, are a very busy individual. How do you prevent that burnout that can come with having so many pressures and whatnot?
When I do it, I invest a lot of my life in my work. So I could be someone who people would see could get burned out. I think there are a few ways of trying to avoid it. I do, you know, have some other activities. I enjoy running in the morning. I run most mornings. I play tennis with a good friend once a week. So there are other outlets. But maybe even more important, there are a lot of satisfaction I get from when I see the impact that the work is having with young people around the world. It's like just yesterday, a close colleague sent me an email that they received from someone who was talking about that they visited their brother. They spent time with their nephew and an 11-year-old nephew who had learned Scratch. And this was a nephew that had lots of challenges, wasn't always successful in, you know, sort of the traditional academic channels, but he'd really become excited about Scratch and start to see themselves in a new way. And it opened up them seeing themselves and the world in a different way. So when I hear stories like that, that helps prevent the burnout, that I just see the meaning that it has in young people's lives.
How do you practice or iterate on your own abilities, either as like an educator or as a researcher or even in computer science?
Well, I do still make Scratch projects, and there'll sometimes be comments from young people in the community where they'll see the iPupper product, they say, you know, didn't he develop Scratch? He's still making Scratch projects? Or they might have been thinking about my birthday, and just so they know my, you know, that I'm a lot older than they are. They say, he's still making Scratch projects. But for me, I still learn and enjoy and get joy from creating, you know, Scratch projects, even just to make an interactive birthday card for a friend. Or I mentioned I play tennis. I did a little tennis simulation to try to understand why our competition was working out the way that it did. So I'll use Scratch just in my own personal expression as well. And then trying to have different learning experiences. Actually, I'd like to do that even more. Like during the pandemic, we all got ukuleles and tried to start learning to play the ukulele, you know, with one another and talk about the learning experience. I also started doing a lot more cooking than I ever did before since I was at home. That was a new learning experience of different ways I could express myself through cooking. So always trying to learn new things. I think I could do an even better job of that. I think I could invest even more on that. But I do think that's something that's so important for all of us to continue to see ourselves as learners.
Yeah, I like that. It's also like helpful, especially from an educator standpoint, to remind yourself what it's like to be at a beginning stage of something. So I'm very slowly learning Japanese, and it's a constant like daily reminder of how much more I have to learn and how difficult sometimes it is to learn something new.
Historically, when you want to learn something new, you become an apprentice to like a silversmith or, you know, the other experts. If we think about what is it we hope our elementary school kids will be learning, learning how to become good learners is probably the most important thing they can learn, more important than anything about multiplying fractions.
Yep.
But if they want to become good learners, they should be apprenticing to good learners. So it's important for teachers to be good learners and for students to see teachers as learners. That's one thing in our after-school learning centers, these clubhouses, we always emphasize to the mentors. We talked before about how they shouldn't just sort of stand back, but they should engage with young people. It's great for young people to see these adult mentors learning new things and to be open about when things don't work. A lot of times the youth in the clubhouse will be surprised when an adult mentor does something and says, I don't understand what's going on. And they'll be surprised. You know, this person who seems like a real expert, they don't understand what's going on. It's great for young people to see that their mentors, their teachers don't understand everything that's going on. And then to see how do they work through that.
Yeah, every Thursday I would share at the start of class, here's a bug that I was working through or I'm still working on from the previous week. So that way kids could like be like, oh, Jared is also experiencing bugs just like I am on a daily basis. What about equity and inclusion? Do you have any recommendations for the field of CS education, how we might improve that?
I guess maybe one thing I'd emphasize there is there's both a who and a how. Sometimes, understandably, efforts in equity and inclusion focus just on the who. How can we get more of people in this category involved? And that's clearly a very good goal. But I think to really be successful, we have to focus on the how. What are the types of ways of engaging which will make people from those groups feel welcome, feel engaged, feel that they can be a contributor, feel that they are a member of the community? So I think we try to focus a lot on the approach and the spirit of the community to make sure it's welcoming to people of all different backgrounds and all different learning styles. And we've often focused to make sure that, like in our work with Scratch, that it's about developing your voice. Because I think if you want people to feel included, they have to feel that they're having a voice. So with Scratch, it's not just learning about the technical skills, but learning how to express yourself and then becoming a member of the community where you have a voice in that community. So I think if we really want to support equity and inclusion, then it's not just a matter of identifying groups, but making sure that we create an environment that's both welcoming and supportive of people developing a voice as full and active contributors.
Yeah, at the time of this recording, there's a recent podcast episode that I did where I unpacked some scholarship talking about Bourdieu and looking at CS implementations and interventions from a Bourdieusian perspective. And so they were talking about how like there's all these like studies that are looking at who, but they're not necessarily talking about the structures of the structures and how that impacts things. And if we want to really have systemic change, especially around equity and inclusion, then we have to focus on that. So that definitely resonates with that particular episode and what they recommended. But I'm curious, so like You run your own research. You work with many people who also run excellent research in your lab. But I know that you can't do everything that you want to do. And I'm wondering, what do you wish there was more research on that could inform your own practices?
I'll start by saying there are different categories of research. I first heard this phrase from my colleague, Natalie Rusk. I think she might have heard it from someone else. But she said, we want to focus more on improving, not proving. A lot of research is focused on proving something. Does this work? Does this not work? Rather, I'd wish there were more research on improving, about how to take something and put it into practice in a way that's going to work better. So it's not necessarily a matter of sort of proving the value of play in the learning process. I think I know the value of play in the learning process, but improving the ways that we can facilitate a playful learning experience, there's so much more we can be learning. And a lot of this does fall in the category of facilitation. How can we put these core ideas into practice? Because I feel there's a lot of research over the years and a lot of evidence over the years that these approaches we talk about, projects, passion, peers, and play, I'm not looking for more evidence to show that these work. I believe they work, but it's hard to put them into practice. How do you facilitate an environment to make sure that these are put into practice in a way that really is going to work in different contexts? And we know that there's not one recipe. So there's so much to learn about how to put these ideas into practice in different contexts. So I'd really like to see more research about how to put these ideas that we really believe in, how to put them into practice in different contexts to make sure that they really take hold.
Yeah, I really like that framing. So whether it was Natalie or somebody else, whoever came up with that, it's wonderful. What's something that you're working on right now that you could use some help with?
Well, let me mention like one project we're getting started on. I'm not sure there's a way to help right now, but there will be in the future. We are certainly, I think, our biggest core commitment is supporting creative learning for young people around the world. And Scratch is one platform that helps support creative learning experiences and has been incredibly successful. But I think on this bigger issue of just how can we support creative learning, there's several efforts we have underway. First, I'll mention one that has been way under for a number of years and people can participate in. It started as a class called Learning Creative Learning. It was an online class, also a class we teach here at MIT. And it evolved from not just being a class, but a community. And several of the people in our research group, including Carmela Persecchi and Lily Gabaret, have taken the lead in recent years of leading this online class and community where educators from all over the world come together to learn about creative learning and share their ideas about creative learning. So that's one way that we support creative learning around the world. And we want to do even more of that. We're getting started on a new initiative that we're calling Creative Learning for All. And it's our effort to build a network, a global network of playful learning communities that support creative learning. And we're doing this, our research group is doing this in collaboration with the Tinkering Studio at the Exploratorium in San Francisco, which is a group that I think has done incredibly creative work also in supporting creative learning experiences. So we're working together of building this network of educational organizations that are supporting creative learning experiences so we can all learn from one another. So our hope is to be able to amplify and elevate some great examples that we see around the world, because there are great examples already, but a lot of times they're not known about. So in this creative learning around the world effort, we want to elevate and amplify some of those examples. We want to have workshops and conferences where people can come together and share ideas with one another. We want to be able to advocate this approach to learning so that policymakers and educational administrators get a better understanding of why this is so important and how it can be put into effect. I will also be creating some new tools and resources and materials to help support educators putting, creative learning into practice. We're just at the early stages, so people should keep an eye out for that. Over time, we'll have more of a presence online where people can find out more about creative learning for all and can both learn from what others are doing and participate in some of those activities.
I imagine there's going to be a wide range of people who'd be interested in that, not just in like education, because like I think the late Sir Ken Robbins TED Talk is still the most popular one that they have on their channel and is all about how schools tend to kill creativity. So yeah, that'd be awesome. Are you intending it for it to be used broadly, or are you thinking within like the scope of education creatively or beyond that?
Our focus is more on, you know, reaching educators and the education world, but also parents. I agree with you that I think it has implications and applications throughout all of society. But I think in trying to, you know, need some types of focus, I think we want to reach both formal education like schools, but also informal settings, museums, libraries, and parents, and also policymakers who support, you know, different education initiatives. I think that's the core audience we'll be looking at.
Yeah, I look forward to learning more about that. What question have you not been asked that you wish people would want to discuss more?
A question that's so important is stepping back and asking the why question. So it's not just about what it is that we're going to teach kids and how we're going to teach them, but why do we make these decisions about, you know, what's important in education? And even taking a step further back, what's important in education is what type of society do we want to live in? So as we were discussing earlier, I think I want to live in a society where it's not just valuing what you can do to be successful in the workplace, but also how to bring joy and purpose and meaning into people's lives. So one reason that I think creative learning is so important is I do think it's the best way to secure success in the workplace in the future. You know, things are changing so quickly. Creative learning and creative thinking will become more important in the workplace than ever before. But it's not just for the workplace. It's also that creative learning also brings joy, purpose, and meaning into your life. And that also is important. And we should value that. And it should be one of the purposes, what motivates how we set up our education systems. So I wish people would spend more time talking about the why questions. Why are we doing all of this? Because if you don't have the right why, the how and the what might be headed in the wrong direction.
Yeah, that definitely resonates with me. I really appreciate that response. It's hard though, because there's a lot of people, especially outside of education, who look at it from a neoliberal lens and assume, oh, well, the purpose of schooling should just be about career readiness and whatnot. And so they don't think about anything else outside of that.
Now, one thing that's somewhat, that I think is fortunate in our current moment in history is that I do think it's pretty well aligned that helping kids develop as creative thinkers, I hope that I would have been arguing for that 100 years ago, 200 years ago, 300 years ago. I think the need for creative thinking in the workplace is much greater now than ever before. So I do think the needs of the workplace for creative thinking and collaboration aligns with the type of education that I would have wanted to provide in any event. So I feel very fortunate that there is more of an alignment now. It is true that, you know, 150 years ago at the beginning of the industrial age, a lot of jobs were just about doing a repetitive thing on a conveyor belt. And creative thinking was not necessarily valued. So an education system that taught you to be disciplined and do things in an accurate, repetitive way was valued in the workplace. That's less valued in the workplace now. So again, 150 years ago, I still think it would have been good to focus on creative thinking in schools, because I think that's so important in our for society overall. Now there's a stronger alignment that we can, you know, still argue for what I think is best for economic success also happens to be what's best for the full human experience as well.
Yeah, that makes sense. Do you have any questions for myself or for the field?
Well, encourage people to be willing to try new things and experiment. The same way that we want young people to be constantly experimenting, trying, take risks, experiment. And that's part of what we mean by play, a playful approach. It's not just about the activity of playing a game. It's about an attitude where you're willing to experiment and try new things. I think educators and policymakers must do the same thing, that we're going to need to continue to experiment and iterate and try new things if we're going to, you know, be successful at this. And then look to find ways to connect with others who have the sort of shared goals, because we aren't going to be able to make this change on our own. We need over time to be able to connect together and work together to bring meaningful change to learning and education.
How do you try and connect with others? So like, do you use specific platforms or specific groups that you go to?
I do some things through my writing. So I will take this as an opportunity to plug my book, Lifelong Kindergarten. It came out a few years ago, but captures the core ideas that we've been talking about today. You know, the subtitle is Cultivating Creativity Through Projects, Passion, Peers, and Play. So that talks about these ideas, both the why and the how of creative learning, and then continue to try to share those ideas through, you know, various posts and other ways of communicating through these online course and community, you know, that we have called Learning Creative Learning. So there we have videos and resources. And I think we want to continue as we look ahead, have more ways of communicating these ideas and more resources to help support people using it. And then I do think the best way for people to really understand these things is through experience. So we'll never stop trying to create tools that enable people to have creative experiences, and running workshops and events that engage people in creative experiences, I think, are so important.
So where might people go to connect with you and the organizations that you work with?
Well, obviously, to check out an example of one of the tools and environments we've created, go to the Scratch website at scratch.mit.edu. On the About page, you can find some resources. But also, you don't have to be a kid to try out Scratch. So there's online video tutorials. Try it out. Let the kid inside of you come alive. Go to the Learning Creative Learning website. If you just Google Learning Creative Learning, you'll find the website for Learning Creative Learning. And on there, there's lots of videos and resources. There's actual courses run from time to time, but the resources are always there. And you can see some of the previous forums, but also the resources and the videos that are there. So I think those are at least some of the ways that you can find out some of the things that we're working on and thinking about.
And with that, that concludes this week's episode of the CSK8 podcast. Thank you so much for listening to this episode. I hope you enjoyed it and consider sharing it with a fellow colleague or posting a review on whatever app that you're listening to this on. Just a friendly reminder that there were many different resources that we mentioned throughout this episode, and you can check those out in the show notes at jaredleary.com. And if you're interested in a Scratch and Scratch Junior curriculum, make sure you check out bootuppd.org, which is the free curriculum that I create that has just under 100 projects at the time of this recording, and more on the way. Stay tuned next week for another episode, and until then, I hope you're all staying safe and are having a wonderful week.